Here's the statement and proof of the error-bound formula for the Taylor polynomial on a given interval. So we have, here's the theorem. Given that f and all its derivatives are continuous, and Pn of x is the nth degree Taylor polynomial for f of x about a, centered at a, and En x is the error between f of x and the nth degree Taylor polynomial on the interval from a, where it's centered, up to x. Then the absolute value of that error is, of course, the difference between the f of x true value and the polynomial value. And the theorem says that that is equal to some m upper bound for the n plus 1 derivative of f on the interval. That's what the m is, upper bound, divided by n plus 1 factorial times the absolute value of x minus a to the n plus 1. So if we can find this m upper bound that bounds all the function values of the n plus 1 derivative on the interval, then we just put it here, and then we can find out what the error will be at any x. Okay, so here's the proof steps that you have to know for a test. First, here's your definition. The error term is the difference between f of x and the nth Taylor polynomial at x. So if you differentiate that, this will be a derivative here, derivative of this. And if you do n plus 1 derivatives, you'll get down to this statement here. But the nth derivative, n plus 1 derivative of the polynomial at x equals 0. Why? The n plus 1 derivative of an, we don't need that, of an nth degree polynomial is 0, and this is an example of why. Example, let's say you had a second degree. So p prime would be this first degree. P double prime, that constant there would knock off. And I put the C one here, as it should have been. Took out the extra and word. And when you take the second derivative of that polynomial, the C one drops off, and you just get 2C2. And the third derivative is going to be the derivative of this constant, which is 0. So the third derivative of a second degree polynomial is 0. So that leads us back to this. The n plus 1 derivative of an nth degree polynomial will come out 0. Okay, step 2. Thus, if you have your n plus 1 error term that you're working on, that's going to be the n plus 1 derivative of f minus the n plus 1 derivative of the Taylor polynomial. But we just saw that that is 0, and why that is. So that's 0 here. So that means you just have this, that the error term for it, the n plus 1 derivative of the error term is equal to the n plus 1 derivative of the function. So suppose the n plus 1 derivative of the function on the interval was bounded by some capital M constant. And it would be bounded by some constant because fn plus 1, the n plus 1 derivative of f, is bounded on, is continuous and therefore bounded on the closed interval. So it's going to max out to some number on that interval. But we just said that the n plus 1 derivative of the error term is equal to that f n plus 1 derivative. So you can just put that right in. Instead of having f there, you got the n plus 1 derivative of the error term. Okay, so we got this statement. So now, with the absolute value, what that means, that just means this, that the error term is trapped in between these. And then we're going to integrate all three from a to x, creating antiderivatives, just a to the x, a to the x. You can certainly do that. It'll preserve ordering for the x greater than or equal to a from a to some interval b. So then the antiderivative of that is negative m t. We're using t instead of x just to not be confused. T evaluated at a to x. And then in here, the antiderivative of the n plus 1 derivative is the nth derivative of the function evaluated at x and a and subtracted. And on this side, the m factors out. The integral of 1 dt is t evaluated at a to x. Okay, but looking at this, what can we do with this? That term right there, the nth derivative of the error term evaluated at a is 0. Why? Because the Taylor polynomial is constructed so that all the kth derivatives of f at a match up exactly to the kth derivatives of the Taylor polynomial at a. Since there's no difference between those two, the difference is 0, that means the error term, kth derivative at a is 0, because there's no error because these are all equal. So that implies that this middle term here goes away and is 0, always. And when you plug in your x and minus the a, you get this. Plug in your x and minus the a, you get this. So now you have this inequality. So now step 4. Repeat the process. Integrate all terms of that inequality. A to x, a to x, a to x. Okay, then, of course, your antiderivative of t minus a is t minus a squared over 2 because the derivative of the inside with the chain rule is just 1, so it doesn't hurt us. Evaluated from a to x, a to x. The same thing happens here again. This error term evaluated a is 0 because all the derivatives of the polynomial match up with all the derivatives of the f, so their difference is 0, so the error is 0 right at a. So that goes away and gets you down to here. Then I showed this step of evaluating in a to x. You get the a there, you get the a here. And this, of course, is 0. And this one's 0. So you just get down to this inequality. Now, just one more time, just for the pattern. Repeat the process. Do your integration. You already have a 2 here. So when you up it by 3 to 3 and divide by the new exponent of 3, the 2, the 1 half is still multiplying there. That's why you get 3 times 2. This term, of course, zeroes out again. Over here, you get the 3 times 2. The value of x, I didn't show the minus the a part, but believe me, it cancels out just like this did. So you end up with this. And I showed it as 3 factorial because that's what it would be. These powers would be piling up on these denominator numbers, creating factorials. And so you have this. And so the pattern that's going on is this. For this first one, when we had the 0 there, and it was just negative m, less than or equal to this, less than or equal to m. Notice that 0 plus n plus 1 adds up to n plus 1. And then when it was a first power over 1 factorial, which is this 1, then 1 plus n added up to n plus 1 again. Then the next one, when it was 2 and n minus 1 for the derivative, that added up to n plus 1. And the last one, when it was 3 on the power, and then you had adding these, the n minus second derivative, 3 plus n minus 2 is n plus 1 again. So in other words, these powers and these derivatives add up to n plus 1. So keep the pattern going, keep on integrating, and finally you're going to end up with this, with an n plus 1 here and a 0 there. So when you add them, you get n plus 1. And of course, the 0th derivative is just e itself, so that's just e. You don't put the 0. And so the absolute value is less than this. And that's very close to our formula. But this proof was for a to b if x was less than a, so it went like something below a to a, it would be very similar proof to this. And so when you combine them together, you get this general statement here with absolute values on both of these. Now in our next video, we're going to use that.